Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents So You Want to Start a Hedge Fund? Lessons for Managers and Allocators by Ted Seides. Narrated by Stephen J. Cohen. Foreword. When I followed one of my mentors, Barton Biggs, in setting up my own investment firm a few years back, I felt uniquely prepared to embark on that effort. After all, I had spent nearly a decade at one of the best-run hedge funds in the business, a number of years at Morgan Stanley, one of the most important brokers servicing the industry, several years as a securities analyst covering the investment management industry, and 10 years teaching Ben Graham's securities analysis class at Columbia Business School. Just through osmosis, I got to know a number of folks who have built wildly successful investment operations. I even sat and still sit on the board of Rick Pzena's eponymous investment firm. What the heck else was there for me to possibly consider? Hang out my shingle, raise a few shekels, and get on with it. Well, before I rang that opening bell, a friend of mine counseled that I should reach out and spend time with Ted Seides. I am glad I did. No one knows more about the startup process for a hedge fund than Ted. He has become a key player in driving the growth of the modern hedge fund industry from its early stage as the popular new kid on the block through awkward adolescence to the mature institutional paradigm that dominates the landscape today. Ultimately, Ted not only became an important early investor in my fund, but also a friend. I am immensely grateful to know him in both capacities. Which brings me to So You Want to Start a Hedge Fund. Prior to college, I must have read every book ever published on baseball. Good, My Turn at Bat, or Bad, Super Joe, The Life and Legend of Joe Charbonneau. The combination of statistics and larger-than-life personalities sucked me in where fiction could not. When it became clear the Red Sox were not going to be in the market for a left-handed shortstop, I turned my literary focus to books on the investment world. I'm not ashamed to admit it. I have read pretty much every book published on investing, from People magazine-like treatments of investment stars to the only true investment Bible, Ben Graham's Securities Analysis. I must have read them all. Amazingly, though, despite explosive growth in the hedge fund industry, there are now more hedge funds than stocks listed on the NYSE, and breathless coverage from the media that vacillates between fawning and schadenfreude. There have been virtually no insightful treatises on the inner workings of hedge funds until today. So You Want to Start a Hedge Fund is the first book written by an insider that looks under the hood of the industry and offers thoughtful views on key success drivers and pitfalls for asset allocators and managers alike. Effectively, through a combination of anecdotes, data, and reasoned judgment, Ted has produced the first owner's manual for the hedge fund industry. Crucially, though, this is not a cookbook. That is, there is no secret recipe inside that says start with a bag of dough, add some quantitative meat, season with experience, and you have an alpha pie, as with picking stocks. While there may be basic true north principles in building or selecting an investment management business, there is also an immense amount of nuance to the process. Ted captures that here. Ted has also seen firsthand virtually every mistake an investment entrepreneur can make. I now know I made a bunch of them, most outlined vividly in this book. For the budding hedge fund manager, trust me, you will find your own creative and original mistakes to make. So you may as well use this book to avoid the more familiar ones. Indeed, one of my chief regrets is that Ted did not write the book 3 years ago so I could have read The Galleys before I launched my firm. Not only might the knowledge imparted from So You Want to Start a Hedge Fund saved me time and effort, it would have kept me out of the damn book altogether as one of the proverbial cautionary tales. Finally, while Ted accuses me of being one of the more likable guys on Wall Street, which, to be clear, would merit a slander lawsuit from any number of today's hedge fund masters of the universe, it is obvious that he has to take the nice guy blue ribbon. After all, only Ted Seides could engender enough goodwill to get me to write a foreword to his first book after subjecting my firm to the financial equivalent of a colonoscopy in his due diligence process. What a wonderful business. It is captured superbly in this book. Enjoy. Steve Galbraith, founder, Herring Creek Capital, Stamford, Connecticut, October 12, 2015. Introduction. A little over two decades ago, I had the good fortune to enter the working world under the tutelage of one of the world's greatest investors, Yale University's renowned chief investment officer, David Swensen. David is a gifted teacher and provided an unparalleled investment education to everyone who had the privilege to work for him. His innovative investment ideas and disciplined framework established the foundation that my former colleagues and I built off in our own ways ever since. From those early years in my career, I developed a passion for investing in people. One of Yale's many levers of success has been its extraordinary ability to partner with top managers across all asset classes in the startup phase of their businesses. Helping someone at a key moment in their career and serving as a catalyst to realize their dreams resonated so strongly with me that it carried through my post-MBA path to the formation of protege partners. I've met so many passionate, intelligent, and high-quality people through my work the last 20 years that this book could not give the vast majority justice. Some of these folks have become world famous, from my first manager meetings in 1992 with Jeremy Grantham and Tom Steyer, to what became an infamous charitable wager with Warren Buffett. Many others have demonstrated fantastic investment success while maintaining a low profile in the investment world and next to none outside of it. Many more never achieved their lofty aspirations, despite Herculean efforts. My role in this ecosystem afforded me the privilege of working with those I believed would be the best of the best, and fostering those relationships over time. It should come as no surprise that many also have become friends. As I once told Warren, I invest in people, the smartest, hardest working, and best ones I know. He responded, I do the same thing. The secret sauce. I wish, after all this time, that I had a secret recipe to deliver success to deserving startup investment funds. Unfortunately, no such recipe exists. A new fund in today's market faces an intensely competitive landscape in an industry with a pre-existing cornucopia of products. Differentiating based on product or price has been tried in just about every way, shape, and form already. A number of managers nevertheless launch successfully every year, thereby defying the odds for startups in aggregate. These firms create meaningful businesses that reward their clients, employees, and ultimately beneficiaries over time. The checklist of essential ingredients for the winners in this game appears generic on the surface: a record of success throughout life, ability to raise money, skill to generate excess returns, development of repeatable processes, creation of suitable infrastructures, attraction and retention of talented investment staffs, temperament and grit to weather challenging times, and good luck. This same set of characteristics describes more failures than successes, so the subtleties in executing each facet of the business matter. This book seeks to describe some key lessons about the opportunities and risks facing startups using historical examples. These stories are not those you hear about in the papers. Billionaire hedge fund managers who have reached the economic pinnacle of a lucrative field, for the most part, don't grace this book. Instead, the principals whose firms I discuss are all highly educated, well-trained, talented, and competitive people who gave it their very best and either achieved success or fell short in its pursuit. I have focused on a slice of a fund's life when success was far from a foregone conclusion. While I believe this work may prove useful to many, we all need to walk our own paths in investing and in life. As much as I have learned to rebuff the words should and ought to in following my path, these same words creep into this book frequently. Please take these words with a grain of salt. They are as much a reminder to me in my daily practice of investing as they are intended to be helpful tips for you. Importantly, throughout this book, I've used male gender pronouns. The hedge fund industry is populated by more men than women, but the convention is intended solely for simplicity. Many high-quality female managers and allocators pervade the industry as well as men. Why now? The hedge fund industry is at a significant crossroads for both managers and allocators. The industry is maturing, aggregate growth is slowing, and competition is shifting from industry-wide growth at the expense of traditional asset classes to market share capture across hedge funds. The structure of the hedge fund industry is highly concentrated in the largest funds, and the big have been getting bigger. According to Hedge Fund Intelligence, only 305 hedge funds out of the 7,500 comprising the universe manage more than $1 billion. This increasing concentration is a consequence of the late-stage development of the industry. The money at the margin entering hedge funds tends to come from large pension funds. These pensions need to invest substantial dollars and face limitations on comprising too much of a single manager's business, leading them to focus only on large funds. However, many of these large funds are overseen by a founder who generated substantial wealth for himself and is approaching retirement age. Firms with leaders older than 60 manage one-third of the assets in the industry, and those with principals in their 50s comprise another third. In time, some of these big funds will not survive their founders, and large sums will get reallocated to different managers. Most hedge fund organizations see this industry landscape evolving and try to position themselves for future growth. The lessons in this book may help small existing funds push the proverbial boulder up a challenging hill. Each year, more managers try to enter the fray as well. A new coterie of talent, typically in the age range of 32 to 38, find themselves with the requisite knowledge, experience, capital, and hunger to strike out on their own. These budding entrepreneurs may have a mentor and some peers with whom they consult, but rarely have access to a wide assortment of prior mistakes made and lessons learned. I hope that sharing these stories will help new funds avoid the errors of some of their predecessors. For allocators, retirement risk has created a need to rethink the composition of increasingly stale hedge fund portfolios. Existing investors in hedge funds across endowments and foundations, pension funds, sovereign wealth funds, financial institutions, family offices, and high-net-worth individuals will have quite different allocations to managers 5 or 10 years from now than the ones they have today. Allocators will need to assess funds in an earlier stage of development than they have historically to build a next-generation portfolio. In its most recent annual investor survey, J.P. Morgan's Capital Introduction Group noted this shift in attention. In their search for alpha, institutional investors have moved down the assets under management, AUM, spectrum, with 3/4 of respondents willing to invest in a hedge fund with $100 million or less. Along those same lines, approximately 70% of respondents are willing to look at a hedge fund manager with a track record of 1 year or less. A dynamic, evolving hedge fund organization faces different challenges from a mature large firm. Allocators are accustomed to recognizing the issues in large firms, but are less knowledgeable about those in smaller ones. In time, allocator behavior will shift away from the buy-and-hold investment decisions that have served them well with large funds. The stories in this book may help allocators avoid some of the mistakes I have made along the way. My work in the past 14 years has focused exclusively on hedge funds, but this book takes no position on the popular debate about the merits of hedge funds for institutional and personal portfolios. While I am positively disposed, both bullish and bearish camps have compelling arguments. On the positive side, the hedge fund industry has undoubtedly attracted some very bright and talented people, and the majority of successful new investment organizations created over the past decade have been hedge funds. These firms have spent more resources on research and development, R&D, than any asset management businesses have in the past. Alpha may flow to where the talented young people reside and where resources are most aggressively deployed to mine for gold. On the other hand, Charlie Ellis astutely points out that the very intelligence and competitiveness of this class of people makes their success inordinately difficult to achieve as a group. Competition has reduced many of the inefficiencies that hedge funds capitalized on in the 1980s and 1990s, and R&D spending may not result in the generation of expected returns. I will set aside the debate with words of the late Peter Bernstein, who was fond of reminding us that we don't know what will happen. Vignettes. I use stories of hedge funds I have partnered with or known about in my time in the business as fodder for this book. Rather than dive deeply into the history and strategy of the interesting leaders of each fund, a style employed by John Train in The Money Masters and many who followed in his footsteps, I have chosen a vignette in the life of these funds to demonstrate a particular lesson. By isolating one issue at a time, I have knowingly simplified the many factors that contributed to the success or failure of the fund. For example, the early chapters that focus on organization and momentum in raising capital leave out the necessary conditions for success of strong performance and an impressive team. Despite these limitations, taken together, the anecdotes build a framework that many managers and allocators may find useful. I hope these stories help lead you down a path of success, whatever that may mean to you. 1. The Lessons. Lessons for Managers. Attracting Capital. 1. Be thoughtful before you speak to prospects. 2. Reflect often on how you present yourself. 3. Offer incentives to get all-important early wins. 4. Dedicate resources to facilitate the marketing process. 5. Create a brand and leverage the buzz. 6. Be prepared in advance and strike while the iron is hot. 7. Diversify your client base to build a great business. team. 8. Investing in people is the best decision you can make. 9. Your organization will evolve, but your culture remains. 10. The two-headed portfolio manager is nearly extinct, so choose a structure more fit to survive. 11. Put your destiny in your own hands. 12. Make the changes you need to thrive, irrespective of external perception. 13. Stay connected to the drivers of your success. Investment strategy. 14. Be true to yourself. 15. When getting started, don't let perfect be the enemy of good. 16. Communicate frequently with clients to sustain a flexible strategy. 17. Anticipate the inevitable ebb and flow of a focused strategy. 18. Pay attention to process and outcomes will follow. Investment performance. 19. Focusing on the short term is antithetical to achieving long-term success. 20. When you think you have arrived, your next adventure will have just begun. 21. If you fly too close to the sun, you're apt to get burned. 22. Never underestimate the role of luck. Allocator relationships. 23. Mirror your potential partner to learn who he is. 24. Strive to give more for less. 25. Be frank about the challenges you face. Teaching something of value may pay dividends down the road. 26. Share your honest assessment of the opportunity, set in good times and bad. 27. When you strip away the label, an allocator's job is a lot like yours. Lessons for allocators. Attracting capital. 1. Your time is precious. Manage it well. 2. The early bird catches the worm. 3. Putting yourself in a manager's shoes may shed light where others see darkness. 4. Timing matters, so separate your decision to invest with a manager from your timing of when to invest. 5. Hot managers may cause you to gloss over important issues. Cold ones may offer opportunities glossed over by others. 6. Follow your own voice when exiting managers. Team. 7. Prioritize talent development in your manager assessment. 8. Expect some ugliness inside the sausage factory. 9. Avoid marriages of convenience with a co-portfolio manager structure. 10. Don't be alarmed by change in a nascent organization. 11. Scrutinize your assumptions regularly when a firm grows quickly. Investment strategy. 12. Write down your goals in advance and make honest assessments of performance against those goals. 13. Investigate the quality of a manager's early results. You may find that some babies are thrown out with the bathwater. 14. Communicate thoroughly and openly with managers to develop a shared understanding of expectations. 15. Pay attention to process, and outcomes will follow. Investment performance. 16. Your interactions may affect your manager's behavior. 17. You will chase performance, so make sure it is for the right reasons. 18. Focus on what matters most. 19. recognize the difference between skill and luck. Allocator relationships. 20. Be your best self in your relationships with managers. 21. Look to startups to extract better terms without adverse selection. 22. Adjust your mental model for the particular circumstances at hand. 23. When you fall in love, take your time. 24. When managers call for the ball, listen. When they run for the hills, proceed with caution. 25. Learn from the best by applying your manager's best practices to your investment process. 2. So you want to start a hedge fund. Chase your passions, not your pension. Dennis Waitley, author and motivational speaker. Seemingly, every workday for the past 14 years, I received word that a friend, friend of a friend, or former peer, neighbor, or neighbor's peer's friend wants to start their own hedge fund. In each meeting, one of the first questions I pose is the same that all allocators will ask. Why do you want to start your own fund? The consistent answer among successful hedge funds takes on some version of it's time. For some, this means they have developed the requisite skill set to manage money and have a burning desire to put their name on the door. Others yearn to break through the constraints placed on their investing activities, whether from liquidity, risk levels, or institutions. Still more are driven by the desire to compete at the highest level.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.